By the way, I just learned Teresa, my Italian student, mailed me, and I have seen all the presentations that I'm holding now are already on the website, including a picket of a picture of this nice ticket with the stamps, and a picture of the website of the coffee shop. So it's already on the website for you there. Mm-hmm. Okay, modeling pathmodel 1, pathmodel 2. This actually we spoke about, right? So this is objects. Objects are used by tasks. If objects are not used by tasks, don't model them. Don't model the coffee cup if it doesn't make sense. But model the ticket that the person is clipping on his clip, and maybe later on the boss is using for something. Agents play roles, and roles are responsible for tasks. Tasks have goals, tasks can have sub-goals, and so on. And events sometimes trigger tasks. This is the whole story. This is the complete description of any task world. And if you go to any book or any paper on task analysis and task modeling, you will find out that this ontology describes it all. It's very simple and it's enough. And if you want to know more about this, go to the website on task analysis. That's public domain. So this is what we have been talking about. We are, for tomorrow, we should start working with this. Look at the organization, the practice, look at the users, look at the documents, and start to model task model one. That's what I would like you to do. So I'm going to talk about collecting task knowledge, because this is what you should do more or less now. And hopefully we are finished earlier than I thought, which means that maybe you can already, some of you can already go to the coffee shop and do some work. So, now, modeling task or collecting task knowledge is a matter of different things. And this one is derived from Bridget Jordan. Bridget Jordan has done a lot of work on finding out about task knowledge, right? Which in people's heads. So, there's knowledge people can speak about, expert knowledge. So, the guy who is handling the machine knows how to handle the machine. You could ask the guy what he is doing. So, the facts of the task domain and skills. Explicit knowledge, because he can probably speak about. Now, you might find out that there are some things that he is able to do, but he won't speak about it. He maybe is not even aware of, he says, this is just routine, this is skill. We call this implicit task knowledge. Now, this is knowledge of the expert. Both the knowledge he can speak about and the knowledge that he can't speak about. But there's also knowledge that's in the environment. Explicit group knowledge. Everybody knows that the full menu of the coffee shop is on the counter. And on the counter you have sheets of paper with all the different possibilities. Maybe nobody can tell you exactly what all is on the paper, but everybody knows it's there. So what's on the paper is knowledge of the group, but it's not in anybody's head. It's actually on a piece of paper. And so you can look at it. You can look at instructions, you can look at documents, and lots of things to find this explicit knowledge. And then there's implicit knowledge. So sometimes the knowledge is the culture. This is how people behave. And nobody can tell you this is how people behave, but people do. So you can see we have we have knowledge of the expert, so the people can, and we have knowledge that's in the environment, in the world. And some knowledge is explicit, people speak about it, or you can read it, or you can watch it, and some knowledge is implicit, you have to understand. Now, I would like to look at all of these four quadrants one by one, starting here.